We've got a lot to talk about because you do a lot of spiritual stuff and I know you do a lot of events. How are you doing today?
Yeah, all good. I'd say I've been working today, so I've just eaten and I've got back and I'm ready there. So always good.
Yeah, great. Let me introduce you to my listeners. I came across Ladrhyn because he's provided sound baths at some of my yoga and handstand mini events. So at a couple of my events, Ladrhyn was he brought his gongs along and like singing bowls and stuff like that. But so you do like retreats and all kinds of different workshops, and I kind of want to jump back in. Like, where was the start of your journey? Because take us to that place.
The start of my spiritual awakening journey, you mean?
Yes.
Okay, well, it's hard to describe. I mean, there's various levels in my life. I remember being about 2 years old and having an out-of-body experience, and my mum basically, I was hitting my mum with this toy hammer. I remember it being like red and yellow, and she just punished me and put it upstairs in the bathroom cabinet. But I didn't see her physically do that. But I saw it in my mind's eye. I remember floating up the stairs and then trying to put my hand to try and grab it because the cabinet was open, and I couldn't. So that was, I guess, that was a bit of a start. But when I first started meditating, after having episodes when I was younger, seeing spirit and things on and off, it must have been about when I was about 14 years old, and 14, 15. And I don't know why. I mean, my father's very much into like meditation and everything, and I must have been picking up on the vibes in the house that time. But basically, I put on some music, which I got from my parents' place. I didn't have much CDs at the time, and it was like a stargazing CD, very relaxing. And I took a I took a Christmas candle, like the long pillar one, from from one of the drawers. This was when I was very young, about 14 or 15. And I just lit it, and I put a sign on my door saying "Do not disturb." And I basically, I know, I just started breathing very heavily, like deeply, and then I ended up stopping because I could feel my whole body like vibrating, and my eyes were shaking with like a lot of energy. And I thought, okay, I went over to the mirror, and I was like, I could see everything sort of vibrating. I was like, this is just odd. I'm going to lay down and wait for this to subside or stop. And basically, what happened was that I don't know how much longer later, but I had a knock at the door, which was my mum, telling me that my dinner was ready. And the angry teenager in me at the time was like saying, F off. And down below, I heard this voice saying, please come back later. So, what had happened was I came out of my body. I was in the corner of the room, and down below was my physical body. And I don't know, basically, maybe spirit or my guides overtook my body and said, please come back later, because it was a new experience for me. But since then, I had been meditating like every day since that period, trying to get to that state, researching more about what was going on. And then when I was in Reading, which was back when I was in Reading, just at, in Berkshire in England, that I met a group of friends who were very much into witchcraft, like, the good stuff, the positive side. So celebrating the wheels of the year, the certain times of the year, doing sort of celebrations, but it never really, it was beautiful, but it never really sort of gelled well with me. So I ended up just doing a lot more research on my own. And then when I was about 18, I moved to Somerset. So that's a bit of the start of the journey.
You made a comment a few moments ago. You talked about seeing spirit, and then you didn't go into it. But what do you mean by that?
I guess, like, you've heard of mediums and psychics, right? Giving readings to loved ones. It was like that. I started seeing like spirit in the house, like I guess ghosts or other non-physical friends, basically, that were in the local neighborhood, with my eyes closed or like as a form. I was always aware of something, basically. But could never quite understand what had happened, if that makes sense.
What do you mean, friends in the local? Like, you
Sorry.
mean it's like you could see what they were doing without sort of being near them?
Yeah, I mean, when we die, we as we either go to the other side, heaven, as you call it, the other side of the of the veil.
Oh, you're on
But then
about dead
there's
people.
Yeah.
Okay, right. I thought you meant like you could see someone going to the pub, like or something. Right. I'm with you. Sorry. Yeah, I'm with you.
It's all right. It's just this different language I use sometimes. So, like non-physical friends, you know, in the
Oh,
local
friends.
neighborhood.
Right.
So basically, a lot of them are very friendly. Some of them, a lot of them don't know where that they're dead still, and this could be centuries that they're trapped in this state. But yeah, it wasn't very clear. It was always like little bits. So like sometimes I saw a hand, or I saw a figure in the corner of my eye, or I felt someone like on my bed. Just things like that, basically. But it wasn't consistent. It was on and off.
So, what do you believe the reason for that is? Like, if they're lingering, why is that?
Well, like now I do a lot of spirit releases, like as some people call Ghostbusters, you know, like I go around and I have the ability to clear out or put spirits into the light to help them pass over. And a lot of it's down to fear. And also belief. It's different avenues. So if someone was heavily, maybe say a Christian, for example, and felt like they did really bad, then they would in be a lot of fear that they're going to go to hell, you know, to the fiery flames of hell, etc. I mean, there is no such thing in my experience. It's more about, I mean, we create our own hell. On the other side is very beautiful, and you know, there's learning there. But we come here to learn. This is a school of learning. So getting over to that other place to pass over to get there is a lot of fear involved because, you know, the last person that I had done a spirit release, which was very hard, he thought I was tricking him, passing him over into the light to basically go to hell. And he was saying this to me. And so he was a lot of, you know, fear and being scared. And yeah, does that make sense?
Do you mean like is this like the same as an is this like someone will get you to come to their house because there's a ghost? Is that what you mean?
Yeah, pretty much. Yeah.
Right.
And out of the many years I've done this, there was one case which he just didn't want to go.
Right.
And so I spoke to a friend who's been doing it for many years, and she said, sometimes they just don't go. You know, it takes a few sessions to get them out, you know, to pass them over. But this guy was very, very stubborn, and he felt like he did bad on the earth, and he knew he had died, but he wasn't still ready to pass over, even though it was a 85 years ago, you know, that he had passed away.
Right.
So,
So it's very individual reasons depending on the circumstances of that person's life, is it?
yeah, totally. Because, you know, look around us, we have all these different thought forms, conditions, beliefs, and everything like that. And yeah, it goes deeper, you know, when you go to the other side, or you know, you feel like you're not ready. There's a lot of souls that are out there who are trapped and need help, but sometimes they're not ready to go.
How does the process work? Is it like negotiation and persuasion, or is it a f like can you force it to happen? How does it work?
It's a mixture of stuff. Like sometimes it's very easy because I guess those souls are very beautiful souls. They just had a lot of fear and upset with them, like a lot of hurt, and so they've been waiting, or some souls have been waiting for to pass over. You know, it's like us in the physical, you know, it's like we're waiting for something, but unless you do something about it, nothing's going to manifest. So there's souls that are floating about, so to speak, that are waiting for the light to go home, and they don't know how. They're stuck. And I guess as light workers, as you call it, some have the ability to, you know, help bring in that light and help them pass over. Yeah.
And in terms of like how you actually do it, I mean, do you do it alone or do you do it with other people? And what is it, like a ceremony? What exactly happens?
No, it's I don't know, it's hard to describe how I do it because everyone's different. Like usually I just hold the space, like I don't know, be in that energy and allow that spirit or that soul to come closer to me. And then there sometimes it's like a portal of light that will open up. I know it sounds a bit crazy. Sometimes that can happen, or there'll be something that they will see themselves. And they will say, oh, I can see my grandparents or my mum, that they would say to me. and be like, okay, well, walk closer, you know, can you see them? And then they're in the light. It's not so scary after all. It's like, again, things that are on the physical that we do in our everyday waking life, some of us have a lot of fear before we even get to the process. And the same on you know, souls that are trapped. They're no different than us. They are human. But how to do it, it's different for every case, because sometimes I need to push a lot more energy to get them out of the way, and to push them to the other side. And it's that trust as well. But it's more about just playing with the energy field of that soul. And also, if there's been like a negative attachment to someone that's living in that house, I have to first pull away basically the attachments that are connected to that person physically living that is in that house still, because there's like these threads of energy that are still attached, because these souls sometimes rely on the people living there to, and usually they're not mediums. They don't have contact to with the other side, and so they're feeling drained. They're hearing things being knocked about, because these souls are kind of like, hey, you're not listening to me, you know, they knock something over or something will happen, and then people get freaked out. But really, it's just spirit most of the time trying to get their attention to say, hey, look, I'm here with you as well in your house, like I don't want to be here.
Right.
It,
So,
you know.
like you say, it's no different than like people that are living, like you might get someone who's trying to get somebody else's attention in normal life and sort of perhaps won't leave them alone or something like that, or won't. And so it's just the same, it's just they're dead.
Well, yeah, I mean, yeah, totally. I mean, for example, it's like I'm in London. I see a lot of, I know it sounds horrible, but I see a lot of homeless people, you know, and maybe the same in other cities that you've been to. And, you know, they aren't constantly asking for money or, you know, and it's just like a lot of people just walk past, you know, all the time. And it's like that with the spirit world, like souls that are trapped. It's like they're asking for help, but no one is there to help usually, you know. So it's a very it's an interesting subject, and it's something that I'm getting more guided to and directed to, more spirit releases on people.
Do you get an impression, like do you immediately get an impression of what that spirit's life story was, or not necessarily? Like do they have to tell you, or can you just feel it and sense it?
Again, it's different. I mean, there are a lot of the times, I mean, I'm quite clairvoyant when in like my mind's eye. Like, I don't see things usually physically, like in the room. Sometimes I do, very, very rarely. It's more internal in my mind. So I'll get pictures. Like, there was one guy who I helped get, you know, put into the light, and he was working. He worked on boats, and I'm not sure exactly what, but I kept seeing like an anchor in my mind, and like boats and water, and I wasn't sure the connection, but I knew there was a connection with boats, for example. And then when I asked the owner, like, you know, was you aware of the owner before? Like, was he working on boats? And they said, yeah, he was like one of the engineers, sort of in the area, you know, going backwards and forth. So it was a very old property where the owner had been there for many years and put up with this all this activity, basically. So it's good to have that confirmation.
My mum gets stuff, and she doesn't really advertise it. She doesn't talk about it. You know, she'll sort of might just tell me in passing, you know, something that happened. And I mean, just like she was with her friend once, and this word just popped into her head, and it was like an obscure name. It was sort of an unusual name, and she just said it out loud. And her friend, anyway, to cut a long story short, it was like her great, I don't know, grandmother or something like that. My dad goes to see like mediums and gets really accurate stuff. There's one particular one it was a lady that he'd seen quite regularly for years, and he'd got to know her. And she called him one day, and she said, "Your father is telling me that you've got to check the showers or something." And my dad was in the process of converting a house into flats, and it was something about he's telling me you've got to go to the top floor or something like that. It's really specific, you know. She called him. Anyway, I can't remember the details, but yeah, he goes to the building site and they'd just been installing the showers in the like, and there was one flat on top and then like two and two, and they just like tiled in the shower, and Dad made them pull it back out again, and it turned out the water pipe had not been connected. So what would have happened is when they turned the mains water on for the whole building, it would have flooded the whole building.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah, it's bizarre, you know. It's there's something going on. I mean, I haven't personally had, you know, experiences, but yeah, for sure, there's something going on.
Well, you've got to see it more of a scientific point of view because, it's all energy and people often get a bit freaked out. They're like, whoa, that's scary. Or like, how do they know that? It's like, well, you forget that, it's like we have like a homing pigeon. like spirit, they can see what's going on. I mean, when you're doing a task, when you're doing a job, we all have these guides, we all have these non-physical friends that aren't physical, that help us, help guide us and give us ideas and look after us. And so they're in contact with other people. So if you already had a communication with a medium, which for example your dad did, then there's that connection already. So when the medium, for example, had gotten the message that, okay, you need to alert so and so because this is going to happen, it's usually the case where someone doesn't know a medium or psychic that, yeah, people can sometimes be a bit lost or you don't know where that information is coming from. I get it all the time, like a lot. It's like I don't know, I can't explain how it is. I mean, one bizarre case was when I was in London 2 years ago. And I just came out of the shower and I suddenly thought really strongly about somebody I went to school with. And it was a lady and she was in a lot of pain, like heartache. I could feel this going on. I think this is very bizarre. Like I haven't thought about this person or heard from them for, 15 years or something. And so basically what I know now is that we all have thoughts like daydreams or ideas or we get lost in our mind. And sometimes we have stuff that comes into our mind all the time that isn't even from us internally. It's something that's external. And what I mean by that is like, if you want to enhance your psychic abilities or your intuitive nature, it's being aware of all your thoughts all the time. So, for example, this person came into my awareness. So I was gingerbread trailing it back to think, okay, what was connected to her? Like, was I connected to her in my mind for another source? Was I thinking about school and then she popped up? Like, no, there was nothing there. My mind was completely blank. So I found her on Facebook, which is Facebook is a great platform for that. And I contacted her and said the story. I said, hey, I just had a miss. Like, you're on my awareness. I'm not sure you're into these, spiritual matters, but I have a sense you do. And I just need to give a message to you. It's something about heartache. And she got back to me immediately and said, yeah, I've just split up with my partner. And things aren't really good. And I was putting the message out there for help. And for some reason, I was the person that was involved. I have no idea why. But for me, that's confirmation, and it's great that I helped her in the end too. So yeah, it's a very bizarre world, but I mean, you just got to see it as energy because it really is.
So you talked about you made friends in Reading and you talked about witchcraft. So tell us more about that.
Well, I had some really fun times there. I mean, it was through my goth stage. I had a bit of a goth stage when I was younger, and I was very into heavy metal and stuff. I guess finding myself, and I was always keeping fit, like just doing like various things, running about and playing football with local friends. And I've always loved Halloween, and that was the first, as they call it, rituals in the pagan tradition. Which was Samhain, or spelt Samhain, which is the pagan sort of Halloween. And so I met a few friends during this time when I don't know how old I was, maybe 15, 16. And every sort of few months, we'll go down the woods and like form a circle and just do like a meditation together. And we had some really phenomenal stuff happen.
Hey,
Like for
Ladrhyn,
example,
just
yeah, sorry.
make sure the microphone doesn't bash. Just like hold it off your
Oh,
shirt or something.
okay, cool. I got that. One of them was called Ostara, which is an old term for Easter, and we were in a field. This was in Reading, and there's about 12 of us, because it had been a while since we got together and more people had joined. So it's the Easter pagan tradition. So this was one of the most beautiful memories I had during that time. So we formed a circle holding hands, and we're under the full moon. And so this is Easter time. So we did calling the quarters, which is like earth, air, fire, water, spirit. And we had all the elements there. And we just like in, I don't know, in honor or like a ceremony to the elements and nature. And so they were calling, everyone was calling the quarters, all the elements. And in the total darkness under the full moon, and we all closed our eyes. And to my left was somebody called Becky. And I was holding her hand. And I could feel like this vibration coming from my hand. It was so strong. It was like as strong as like a vibration when your washing machine is on like spin, when it's like tumbling really fast. And I was like, this is really odd. This is, I don't know what's going on here. And then a few minutes later, we were there for like a while, just closing our eyes. And then I remember another friend called Vicky. She said, oh my God, look at all the rabbits. And we opened up our eyes, and all around us was about 50, 60 rabbits that had come out. And we're just like, this is bizarre. We're standing in a field doing this ritual under the full moon, and it's Easter, and there's all these rabbits about. So, yeah, we had some really interesting times. It went on for about a year and a half doing various things. But, yeah, some very, you know, magical moments, basically, which really opened up my eyes to, I guess, spirituality.
What does Halloween mean? What does it represent? How did it start?
What, the idea of Halloween?
Yeah, I mean, why do we do it?
Again, a lot of our festivals that we do, like Christmas, and it's all part of something called the Wheel of the Year, which is in to do with the pagan tradition. So Samhain, Samhain, which is Halloween, is basically like the pagan New Year. It's basically like when the veil between the afterlife and the physical is thin. So it allows the spirits to come through and connection. And this is why we do trick or treating, and there's like, you know, ghosts and skeletons about. And in modern times, like now, it's more about, you know, trick or treating, having some sweets and knocking on the door and dressing up. But really, you know, the tradition goes much older than that. It was literally, and it still is, where the veil between the worlds is thin, where contact from the other side was more powerful. And so the pagans, you know, many thousands of years ago would honor and celebrate this important time. And usually around a full moon, but it's usually 31st of December, sorry, October.
I was going to ask you something else. Seances. No, wait a second. What do you call it? You know the Ouija board thing. Is that called a seance?
No, that's just called a Ouija board. But seances is basically a term where I can't remember, there's a Latin name for it, which means something. But it's basically when you're in the dark and you have very low light and you're raising energy and having contact with spirits, putting them into the light or having contact, like communication. So seances is a very interesting very interesting area, basically.
I mean, is that different to the process that you described earlier when you're like clearing a house or something, or is it a different thing?
No, that can happen. So seances, it's usually where a lot of like people come together who are mediums or healers or very much, you know, dedicated to spirit, and usually there is a medium present. And if you know about like trance mediumship, where you allow a guide to come through and speak through the medium, sometimes spirit can come through like a lost spirit and basically say that they're lost and they need help. And so that can happen sometimes in a seance where there are trapped souls and you can put them into the light. But every seance is different. Every group is completely different, the way they hold and the way they... Their true purpose or meaning, basically.
Why does it have like such a negative association? Is that just because of movies and Hollywood and stuff, or is it? Can it be like that?
Yeah, it's most likely. I mean, I would love to find a new term of the word seance, because it can put people off. Because, like what you said, instantly you think about the Ouija board and conjuring up the dead, which isn't half true. It's just the way it's not as, dark and negative as people think. It can be very, very beautiful, and most likely it is. When you have contact from passed over loved ones, it's just messages. There's nothing scary about it. It's actually very beautiful. And the way how many movies we've watched where we've seen hauntings and ghosts, and that's all entertainment. And if you were to film a seance, like, I guess from a viewer it might seem boring, but when you're actually there experiencing stuff, it's a completely different story,
I
and
see.
very beautiful.
So that's not a process that is a negative or dangerous thing to you then.
No, and it never has been. I've been part of many circles over the years, and recently, more seances than the last year and a half or so, and it's all been very, very beautiful. It's more down to, again, everything's down to fear. We have two basic human emotions, love and fear. And usually, if something is scaring somebody, it's a fear, because it's usually the fear of the unknown. They don't know what's going to happen. Again, it's the conditioning from movies where people think, oh, it's going to be, I'm going to get spooked. I mean, what we're dealing with when we hold a circle at a seance, is that it's all done in protection. It's all done in love and light. We're working with our guides. It's all very peaceful and beautiful, and there's nothing there to harm you or hurt you, and we're all really protected. It's, again, if you go out there wanting to be hurt, then you can do, and I'm talking about physically. If you go out into the world and use yourself as a target, then you're going to get hurt in one way or another, mentally or physically, if you allow yourself,
Right. With or without
and
ghosts, you're going to manifest that regardless.
yeah, exactly. Yeah. And so really there's more dangers out in the real world than there is in seances, to be honest,
Yeah, I mean, crossing the road is more dangerous than a ghost, isn't
Exactly. Yeah. When you're sat in the dark, nothing's going to harm you.
it?
But, if you have your eyes closed crossing the road, or not paying attention, or you're too much in your mind and not really present, then yeah, you're going to have an accident.
Yeah,
So,
right.
yeah, totally.
Tell us about your retreat. I guess is it your family home, the retreat place?
It is. It's a beautiful space. We moved there in 2004, 2 days before Halloween, actually, 29th of October. And it took us about 7 or 8 years as a family to build the place, not from scratch. Like, we had to do a lot of alterations, extensions, the gardens. It took many years, and it was all us doing work. Like, my uncle put up the plasterboard. Sorry, you did the plastering. A lot of the brickwork. We had a builder there. My dad did a lot of the tiling and, like, some of the plumbing. I did a lot of the gardens and the plasterboard and the electrics for, like, the headphone jacks. My mum painted. It's been a really, big joint family effort.
Hmm.
And now it's really paying off, because, there's less to do, basically.
So what are the events that you run there or have run?
Me personally,
Yeah.
you it's two, like, two or three different things I do. So I do retreats called timelessness retreats, which is basically you turn off your phone, take off your watch, you have no sense of time for about 3 days, and we do, like, meditations. So there's accommodation there too for, like, 17 people, and each bed, you have your own single bed, has a headphone port by the wall, which is all connected to the audio room where I play guided meditations. So I wake people up in the morning. We do, like, lucid dreaming, like dream recall, for more positive thinking. And there's great food, and basically people just, like, listen to audio, like, for 45 minutes or an hour, come back down, have a group share on the experiences. And a couple of times a day we do, like, a gong bath. And the timelessness stuff is really powerful, because you're not trapped in this reality anymore, where you have to look at a phone and know what time it is, and you're getting lost. You're actually, not attached to that at all, and you're back to your default setting, your internal, rhythms, ideas, and insights. And it's been really helpful for a lot of people. Other retreats I do is like lucid dreaming and things like that. So it's good.
Just give us an explanation of lucid dreaming.
It's a big umbrella term. It's more about consciousness exploration. That's an umbrella term for one of them is lucid dreaming. And lucid dreaming basically is being aware that you are dreaming. So a lot of us have had dreams, and some people in the spiritual community get very confused. They said, "Oh, I had an out-of-body experience last night." And we're like, "Oh, really? Where did you go?" And we're like, "Oh, I couldn't make it out too well." But an out-of-body experience is when you're really fully out of your body. You're aware about everything in the room or your environment. You can interact with it, touch things. You can move about. You can go anywhere at will. And lucid dreaming is, again, being more aware that you are dreaming and being control of your dreams. Not a lot of people have a lucid dream, but it's usually a very deep dream experience. And it's like you're in this spectrum of consciousness, basically. You know, if you think about daydreaming starting, then you have dream states, like deep dream states, then you have lucid dreaming, and then you have like out-of-body experiences. You could be anywhere on that spectrum, like during your time waking and sleeping. And it's all down to how conscious you are in that dream state, in that consciousness state. Yeah, does that make sense?
Yeah, I think I remember having a lucid dream once. It was extremely vivid, and I can remember distinctly feeling like I could completely choose, I could just walk around in the dream, like as if I'd walk around normally, and I was aware I was dreaming. Yeah, it was, and I was on a boat. I was on like a big ship, like a, I don't know if it was like a oil tanker or a cruise ship or a military ship, or I'm not really sure. But yeah, it was extremely vivid, and yeah, I knew I was dreaming. Is that a lucid dream?
Yeah, pretty much. And if you master that more, then yeah, you can completely control, you know, more around you. And there's, you know, some people have been in dream states where they've learned how to play the piano in the dream state, and then they've woken up and able to, you know, play the piano that they've never done before. So it's there's lots of potential to it. You know, it's not just, oh, you know, you just want to learn how to dream. It's no, it's deeper than that, because you can act out your deepest, you know, dreams and desires that you can't achieve. I mean, for example, think about it. Like, if someone has a disability in his physical life, like, you know, if someone can't walk, for example, you know, then they can have an amazing dream where they're like running, you know, and they're getting that feeling back where they can feel the floor underneath them. They feel that, you know, can feel their legs moving, and they can almost feel it very physical. And but obviously the reality is when they wake up, they don't have that connection with their legs anymore, so they can't, you know, run. But at least it's some hope for some people, you know, which they can't get their dreams literally. It's so it's a powerful tool, good for manifestation, good for like ideas, and yeah, it's just a really multidimensional you know, area where you can achieve anything really.
How often does it happen where you like something gets verified in an out of body experience? Like you were saying about the hammer in the upstairs cupboard or something. Like, is that Does that often happen where in that altered state, you go and see something and then it turns out to be really there?
There, yes and no. I mean, you can have an amazing experience and know that it was true and vivid, but the thing is, there's also different levels of reality. So we have something called like non-consensus reality, and so basically, if you come out of your body, you may not be in this physical reality. You might be in a duplicate of this physical reality, and so imagine your kitchen, for example. If you have an out-of-body experience in your kitchen, but it's mirrored, you know, the cupboards are on the other side of the wall, the door is out of place, so you can be in this dream environment where it's not how it actually is. So there are different levels of reality where it may actually be this time frame, or it might be another one. But yeah, answering your question about having evidence, there's quite a few out-of-body explorers out there. One of them, Graham Nichols, if you've heard of him.
No.
He's from London originally, but he lives now in Estonia. And he was actually doing a talk. I can't remember the full story, but from what I remember listening from him. He was doing a talk somewhere, and suddenly he collapsed on the floor, and he had like an out of body experience, and he was taken somewhere in London outside this pub, and then he saw this big explosion or something happened. I can't remember the full story again, but I think he went to that place, checked out exact same what it was, but nothing happened. But like a week later, a bomb had gone off. And so he's written about this experience, I think, in his book, or he's got something on his website about that. So, yeah, things can, you know, a lot of the time things can be proven and, you know, and for evidence. But usually it's not that extreme. A lot of it that we have is usually just for our own belief, you know, to help us. Again, we have guides, we have non-physical friends all around us all the time, helping us, supporting us. Most of the time, we're not aware that they're there. But if you think about the times when you've just had an amazing idea pop into your head and you don't know where it came from, sometimes it's from your guides helping you. And so they're with you a lot of the time during the night, like, you know, waiting for you to pop out and have an experience and help give you some healing and some ideas. And so, you know, they will guide you. And again, these dream experiences that people have, it's more about the validation of consciousness in themselves. So when you have an experience, it's something that's personal to you that, you know, you don't need to share with anybody else, but it's kind of like, wow, I wouldn't have known that at all. Like, you know, how could I have known something that happened? Mm. And I often get stuff like it's like the weather. Sometimes it's rainy, sometimes it's sunny. It's the same with the dream state. I can have very powerful, vivid dreams and something that I'm seeing in the future, and then it will happen like a week later, or sometimes I don't get anything at all. So yeah, it varies.
Mm. I remember having a premonition of a car crash once. I kept feeling the sensation of like getting like a car driving into the side of me, you know, quite forcefully. And it, yeah, I kept sort of imagining it, and yeah, having the sensation. And then like a couple of months later, it happened. It wasn't serious, like I wasn't injured or anything, but somebody from the right kind of smashed into me, and it was the exact sensation. As soon as that happened, it stopped, you know. I didn't have that that thought anymore after that. You can't prove this stuff, but yeah,
no. And again, it's individual. It's about your own truth, you know, about your own journey, about where you're going. And sometimes those messages are messages, you know. It sounds negative, like, oh, you know, be aware of a car crash, you know. It's like, okay, what's happening there? But sometimes it's spirit trying to, you know, your guides trying to help you to say, okay, be aware about something. Maybe they would have helped stop the situation even more. Maybe it would have been a more worse impact, for example, you know, because you're aware of the state. Perhaps a part of you had stopped the process to not have such a bad accident. You understand what I mean?
Mm. Do you have any thoughts on extraterrestrials?
Yeah, totally. I definitely know that we're not alone. And I mean, there's plenty of evidence around the world from that. If you look at ancient traditions, ancient cultures, as you know, like Peru, Tiwanaku, like Stonehenge, Egypt, you know, it's looking at the way they built the structures. There's so much evidence left behind that really it wasn't, you know, these stones weren't carved using bone antlers and everything like that. It's virtually impossible. Mm. I mean, when I went to Malta, there's something called the Hypogeum, which is like Latin for basically like underground. And it's this underground tomb that they found when they were digging the floor. I think it was in like the year 1956 or something. And they were digging the floor for in a street for some foundations, and the floor collapsed, and they went into this, you know, this like cave environment, and they found this whole tomb, which was carved out of solid rock, and in there was like 88,000 sort of dead bodies, like catacombs, like all these remains. Hmm. And it was all perfectly carved, and when they excavated, when they're doing finds like digging down deeper, they kept finding more complex jewelry and other items, like deeper they went. So the older that they got down more into the dirt, into the earth, they found more complex jewelry and everything. you know, and it's like, think about it with Tutankhamun in Egypt. Like his tomb was one of the biggest discoveries found, and they found an iron dagger in there, which never got rusted at all. And around then, there was no iron. So there's some very bizarre things. It's like, again, Egypt is filled with so much evidence that we're not really, you know, that whoever was there, wasn't just from Earth, because there's so many clues. Like, if you look at the pyramids, if you know about this, the three pyramids of Giza, it lines to Orion's belt. And inside one of the Great Pyramids, there's four shafts, which when you're in the center of the pyramid, you look out the one each shaft, and it points to certain stars at certain times of the year. The base of the pyramid is 365.4 pyramid cubits, the way they measure, which is like our year basically. And each one is 2.5 tons, each block of the pyramid. And there's only 2.5 million blocks. And I think Andromeda or the Pleiades, it's supposed to be like 2.5 million light years away. So there's all these like little clues. And that's just one example. But yeah, you look around the world, all these ancient cultures that no longer exist anymore. There's hieroglyphics, stone cult like sculptures with aliens on there. There's so much evidence around the world. It's hard to think that we are alone. I really doubt that.
I don't look at that stuff so much anymore, but there was a time where I used to watch a lot of that kind of thing. Yeah, I was really into it. Have you ever had the sensation of connecting with like a ET sort of consciousness or something?
Well, one of my guides is, and I know this because I've seen him a few times. And when I've had my eyes closed meditating for quite a few years, when I was meditating, when I have my eyes closed, I see like blue energy, and usually that forms in the shape of like spirits. Like I can see their eyes and like the side of their nose, and I'll see them floating by. And then for years, I kept seeing these like alien eyes in front of me, and I didn't know what it was. And then after having more contact with my guide, I found that yeah, he's not from Earth. He's an ET. And so for me, I know for sure that we aren't alone, and I've had some contact in a sense, non-physically. I guess he's like a spirit in that way. But in 2007, on Christmas Eve, going back many years now, I was researching a lot of this. And so my awareness was very much into aliens. I was just very, obsessed with learning more and learning more. And then I was doing care work in Somerset, and I was driving home, and I noticed what I thought was Orion's belt, the three stars in the sky, but it was a bit cloudy. And I was like, oh, Orion's belt is a bit light tonight. Just a strange comment to think about. It doesn't get bright at all. And I saw these three objects go over me quite fast. And I got my phone out and took a picture, but nothing came out of my phone. I kept taking pictures, nothing would come out. And yeah, it was bizarre because I saw them with my eyes. I mean, there was no sound. It was going at, much faster than an airplane in the sky you
It's
see up.
moving.
Yeah, it was moving, yeah. It was going about five times faster than like a plane in the sky, going straight over me. And each like light was maybe a quarter the size of the moon when it's full. So it was quite a big light. And I didn't know what this was at all. But they kept in formation, they moved, and they kept going into the distance. It might not have been that at all. It could have been some Chinese lanterns, which I thought potentially it could have been. But I've seen other things too, which doesn't make sense, like colored lights flashing, and I've seen like a star, which I thought was a shooting star, then turned like a 90 degree angle and then shoot off in a different direction. So yeah, I have no idea.
I used to have a few friends, right? And this one particular friend, I used to be a bit more. Anyway, he was basically a tax advisor. He was not a hippie. He was not into spiritual stuff. He was very much into business and like the stock market and stuff like that. He was kind of a big money kind of guy. Nice guy, good fun. And for a little while, I kind of became friends with him because we had a mutual friend. And me and the other friend were going through a phase of watching these things like we're talking about, you know, about, you know, aliens, conspiracy theories, all that kind of stuff. And Jarl says to us one day, he's like, "Oh, you don't need to show me these DVDs. I've seen it with my own eyes." He's like Scandinavian or something. He was like, "When I was a little boy, you know, walking through the fields with my friends, we were like 5 years old or something." And he said these huge balls of light sort of came down to the earth and were spinning around like a massive triangle or something. And then it just shot off at a million miles an hour. And he's like, "I don't need to see these DVDs," he's saying. And it's funny because he's just not the kind of guy that would usually expect to have a conversation like that with, you know.
Yeah, definitely. It's and usually you find these people that they don't seem like they're into this at all, and then you just talk openly about something, and you find that the people that you less think expect to be into any of this or believe it are the ones that you least expect, basically. And it's quite a shock sometimes.
Hey, something else that happened to me. Did I ever tell you about the blood type story?
I can't remember. You might have done.
I started video blogging and putting videos on YouTube like years and years ago, probably around about 2006, because I started off doing online guitar lessons and then I carried on doing blogging and stuff. Anyway, I get a message one day from someone who'd seen my videos and he says, "I think you're this particular blood type." I can't remember what it was. It was like rhesus negative something.
Yeah, rhesus negative. That's right.
I can't remember. Yeah, something like that. It was quite a rare one. Like it was only like 5% of people have it or something like that. He said, "I think you're that blood type," which I thought was strange because he'd basically, that was just from seeing me talk, you know, on YouTube. And he said, "Go on eBay, get one of those little blood tester things and find out." And he was right. I ordered it and he was right. I was this like relatively rare blood type. And I just thought that was strange. He said, "Yeah, I could just tell from your personality that you are."
Weird. Yeah, it's interesting, blood types. I mean, going back, like, I'm very much into ancient cultures and not so much the conspiracy theory stuff, but it's more about the evidence that's there. You know, there's a misconception about, "Oh, you're into conspiracy theories." It's like, no, there's actual evidence around the world, as I said earlier about, you know, Egypt. It can't, like what a friend said to me recently, if it sounds like a duck, then it's most likely it is a duck. Do you know what I mean? Yeah. It's like, if all the evidence is there and it shows that it's something, then it's most likely it is. Mm. And it's most likely that we didn't all pop out from the same monkey, you know? I don't think that we evolved from monkeys as such. I think that we were a race on Earth that were the evolving humans. And I definitely believe that our genes were altered in some way, because we got to see it like a big evolution scale, that whoever's out there in the universe, like, and think about it, us, like, you know, we have dominance, you know, we have governments, we like to own land and, you know, politics and other things. It's like it's in our blood almost, you know.
Yeah,
it's like, and the procreation, you know, like you know, to procreate, and we're just getting so overpopulated. It's like, well, where are we going eventually? You know, are we to seed other planets out there, or to do something, you know, we're doing to science and DNA? And it's most likely that our ancestors, you know, whoever they were, you know, helped evolve us a little bit. Because if you look at the findings from, like, for example, you know, evolution, going from the first ape to man now, science cannot find the link between human and ape. It's not there. So it's most likely that our genes or our DNA did get changed or upgraded at some point, you know, because, you know, it's clear that we're the dominant being on this planet. You know, buildings, and we're overtaking, we're technology and everything. And it's, you know, that's not normal on Earth. You know, no other animal is doing that.
Yeah,
you know, we don't see a bear.
We're nothing like the second most, like the second species down. We're nothing even close to them, are we?
No, you don't see like a bear, like, you know, waddling to the to the pond and like, you know, grabbing a fish and then you getting a frying pan and lighting the fire and, you know, doing that. You don't see any other animals doing what we do in nature, you know? And it is alien. You know, it's not normal. And so we got to see, like, we're not really from here, you know, the way we have to sort of shield our eyes from the sun and, you know, wear sunglasses. I mean, it's going to a different subject here, but I'm not sure what I believe. I know that it's clear that we're not really from here. Our genetics aren't really from here, because there's so much evidence there that shouts that, you know?
I try and find, like, when you have to try and find a balance between being completely, like, so open that to the point of being gullible and just believing anything. But then at the other end of it, the extreme, a lot of people are more at the other end. They're so close-minded. They think they know everything, and like they just can't believe there's anything out there that they haven't thought of yet. It's like that's like. And then somewhere in the middle, there's like a rational skepticism in there where you're like, I try and find that balance. Like, I accept that I have no idea what goes on in the universe. I don't know how the world works, and there's probably a lot of stuff we don't understand, so I'm kind of open to it all, but also take it with a pinch of salt, as best I can.
Yeah, totally. I mean, we may be the only, you know, in theory, we may be the only species in the universe at all on this planet. And the reason why it's so hard to find other life out there is because we're not meant to find other life out there, for example. You know, it's like we're supposed to focus on us, you know, and what we're going through and our evolution. I mean, we're still a baby in a sense of, if you look at the whole of Earth, there's still wars, there's fighting. You know, we're not really ready to really leave Earth and, you know, seed other planets if that's the potential, because we got to find perfection here, and we still haven't done that because there's so many homeless people. People are mentally ill. People are struggling. People are lost. People are lonely, you know. And this time of year, you know, Christmas coming up, there's a lot of people that are on their own, and you know, we haven't mastered so much stuff. And the biggest thing is that, you know, that these spiritual things aren't put into schools, not spiritual as such, but, you know, emotional intelligence. You know, we're not taught about that at school. We're just taught about English, math, science, and then we have all this problem that we have to go back home to. Not everybody, but some children have issues at home they have to face, and they don't know how to face it. And so we're not taught the certain things at school that we should be, which is helping humanity, really, is having these, you know, I guess, lessons at school about relationships, about how your emotions work, and, you know, addictions and things to expect when you leave school, because, you know, people don't really find themselves until, you know, they're mid-30s or something, you know?
I
And
agree.
yeah, totally. And I think that's something that needs to change. You like, I think that's something that needs to be put in, is that don't just, you know, teach maths, English, science. It needs to go deeper than that. It needs to be an understanding about who we are and how to deal with ourselves. Because if this doesn't get put in, then it's not gonna fix anything, you know?
Yeah, we got a long way to go, haven't we? We are not a finished
We have.
product yet. We got a
No.
lot of things to fix.
No.
Hey, let's talk about the sound baths. So, at what point
Sure.
did you start doing that?
I mean the sound as such, I started doing that. I think around about 2009 or 10, I think it was. I started with like singing bowls and just my voice, and just doing like harmonics. You know what harmonics and overtones is?
I mean, I used to play guitar, but what do you mean? How were you generating them?
It's basically just through the voice, so you can create two or three tones at the same time just by like doing a hum or an om type thing. And it puts out, I guess, different wavelengths of sound in the room, and it can be quite therapeutic for some people. So I was just part of like a number of like spiritual groups around like Glastonbury and London and Somerset. And I would just sometimes just well, especially in Somerset, I'd find like an empty church. I love churches for the acoustics, and just sing like hum and om and things. And people used to just, I used to open my eyes after like half an hour, and there'd be a few people just sort of laid on the floor, or, joining in, and it sort of evolved from that. And when I did the first open weekend at the retreat in Somerset, the family home that I'm at too, there's a guy called Tim Wheater who came with some gongs, and he did like a little concert for us playing. And that's the first time I heard a gong, and everyone was relaxed after. And I didn't think you could buy them. I thought they were only for special, musical people. And so that was the first one was 2010, the open weekend. And it wasn't until, I guess, 5 years ago, that's when I first got my first gong, basically.
Right. And how does it work? Are they custom made or?
Yeah, like the biggest I've got is 42 inches, and that took about 2 months to make on and off because it has to go through a heating and cooling process, and it has to be hung for the gravity. So the faces of the gong aren't too tight or soft. It allows them to vibrate and produce sound. So they go through a heating and cooling process and like striations, like scratch marks in them to produce different sound. So basically they can be tuned to the love of the sound, basically. And some gongs can be tuned to frequencies.
Were you involved with the process?
No, I wasn't, unfortunately. It's a bit of a secret because if everyone knew how to make a gong, like then people will probably end up, going to buy and, make their own. But it's not hard, I guess. I've seen them how they make it. Not in person yet. But it's a lot more complicated than that because there's certain depths of the scratches, the striations that in the metal, different thicknesses. There's loads of different things.
And when did the lights come into what you do?
When I was about 15 or so years old, my father's been into to lights for many years, and he had these something called an audio strobe, which is basically like glasses, like sunglasses with LED lights in, and he would put them on and just get zoned out, and I'll do the same, and you'll see pictures in your mind's eye. But the actual lamp, the light machines, my father went to an exhibition in I can't remember what year it was, must have been about 2013 or 14, and saw one of these light machines and introduced it to one of the people at the Handel Star community, the company. Well, he wasn't part of it at the time because it wasn't created. And he says, "You've got to check out this lamp." And so the Pandora Star was basically came from my father in a sense because he introduced it to one of the directors of now the Pandora Star community, and just by showing him another lamp, and this other lamp called the Lucia light machine is a lot of money. It's like it's the price of like two or three cars sometimes. It's a lot. And so an engineer tried to basically just create something that was a lot more compact and easier to sort of, be transportable and more affordable, even though they are expensive. But it took 2 years to develop. So I've been involved in a few companies with light machines for many years, and learning more about photic driving, which is basically like, binaural beats.
Yeah, I've heard of that, yeah.
So binaural beats is basically you have a tone in the left ear of 100 hertz, for example, and then in the right ear of the headphones, you have like 104. And so the difference of 100 and 104 creates a third tone in the center of your brain of 4 hertz. So that's how binaural beats work. But with photic driving, like photic light stimulation, we've all had this our whole lives. Like if you sit in front of a TV, it could be like 40 or 50 hertz, for example, the way it flickers, but you can't see it flickering. A standard light bulb can be between 80 and 100 or 200 hertz, a lot more higher frequency. So the certain lights that you have on in your home, they can actually keep you quite alert and awake. They're not actually giving you relaxation. And this is why flickering light can be quite powerful. So basically, like when you're at sleep at night, you're in delta, which is between 1 hertz to 3 hertz. So if you have a long, short flash of a light going on and off very slowly, that will put you into a more of a delta brainwave for like sleep. So eventually, it will It's like shamanic drumming, if you know about shamanic states where people are drumming and it's a constant like drumming tone, like dun, 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 dun. Eventually you're entrancing yourself.
Right.
So you can do the same with a light, basically.
I see. Right, yeah, so it's like visual binaural beats.
Yeah, although binaural beats is something different, that's using two tones, using the two ears. But right. You have something called isochronic tones, which is a constant tone, which after a while, it's just entraining you, like training your mind to get to a certain place.
Right.
Desired place.
Yeah, I like trance-inducing music. I quite often put that on, just to relax or go to sleep to or something.
Yeah, and it doesn't work for everybody. Again, if you're hardwired and you understand about the process and you've had enough training, like with the trance stuff, like if you know that a shamanic drum, like a certain beat after a while, like a steady beat of dun, 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 if it can be sound boring to somebody, but if you allow that to use it as a tool, it can really put you into a trance. And there's a lot of shamanic practitioners which use a typical drum, and that's the reason. You know, again, there's a lot of science behind all this. It's not just the fact of just, you know, whacking a drum and being spiritual. It's deeper than that. You know, there's actual reason. And again, so much is getting lost in this modern world because so many people are literally lost. They're doing these practices, but they have no idea why or the reason behind it.
What stuff are you reading, or who are your teachers, like, that you learn from or follow or listen to?
I don't read. I can read. It's just I just start daydreaming. Reading just doesn't do anything for me. Mm-hmm. So I'm more of a hands-on person. Like, I would prefer to go into workshops and get my hands into things. But I like listening to audiobooks as well. So when I'm driving or walking about or doing something physical, I can learn things. But it's usually being around like-minded people that I learn a lot more from, because I'm more in there in the situation and asking questions. And I'm, as you know, I'm a very open person, you know, and I'm honest and open, and I talk about all sorts of things. I'm not scared about, you know, experiences and psychic wacky crazy, you know, experiences. So I'm just an open book, and when I talk to people, I learn through them too, and what their ideas and perceptions are of reality. And so it helps me broaden more awareness into this world, you know. I guess even me talking to you right now is, you know, I guess a lot of this is about my perception on life. And in that process, I'm still analyzing and thinking how I see the world, you know. So I'm learning in that sense too, which is, you know, very beautiful.
Where do you see yourself in 10 years' time? Like, are you somebody who just goes, are you more in the moment and you go on your intuition and you're not really sure where you're going to end up? Or have you got very clear sort of plans and visions?
I think it's like a lot of people. I think, again, because a lot of us have dreams, you know, and I know you do as well, but it's like a lot of it comes down to money, right? You know, we have these big ideas and dreams, but sometimes we find it hard to get to the place we want to be because there's money involved. And it's sometimes if you look back on past experiences, you can see how much you've manifested or created. And it may have taken a couple of years. But the thing is, we're so impatient now as a society. Everything's impulse buying, like online. You can get it straight away. You can ask Google anything, you get an answer. We're almost getting hardwired that we're getting impatient. But really, it's about being patient and, you know, just keep manifesting and keeping a focus on where you want to be. For me, I love the warm weather. So at the moment, it's okay. It hasn't been too cold. At the moment, it's been at 13 degrees. But when it's like 1 degrees, I just don't feel at home. So my dream really is to be either abroad somewhere in the wintertime and have a home there, have some land and have a family, grow food and be like off grid and do like mini workshops that way. And in the summertime, come back to England and be at our retreat center and do that. Or if that doesn't work out, getting land abroad, then the plan is to buy some land next to the retreat and build like a 30-foot geodesic dome, which is like, you know, the Eden Project?
Yeah.
So having like a huge dome like that, that I can just be in nature and be warm and be around the elements. So that's another dream. So yeah, 10 years' time, I would love to manifest that.
I went through a phase where I was like considering, well, I actually did a couple of mock-ups, right? I was going to build a geodesic dome because I always quite enjoyed tents and temporary structures, and I worked at a few festivals where I was setting up marquees, and I quite enjoyed it. It's like, you know, it's quite fun. Yeah, I got it into my head I wanted to build a geodome, and I started off with straws just to figure out the maths and the geometry and how it works and just get my head around it. And then I ordered off of eBay like a bulk broomstick, like a pack of 150, and I made, yeah. And it wasn't really successful because I made it a bit too complicated. I chose the geometry that was like had too many parts to it. I should have done the simpler version. It was like ego getting in, and it was like 6 foot high, made out of wooden broomsticks, and I kind of gave up on it because the amount of time it took to like set it up and take it back down again, like the festival would be done, you know. I did dabble around with it for a little bit. Those kind of structures are really cool.
Yeah, and it's you know, and round dome structures is very beautiful because it's like an egg, you know. It's the way the architecture of the egg, like being inside, it's, you know, you're cocooned and there's loads of space. And yeah, I love round structures. You know, I prefer them than square. Like, I'm in London at the moment in a flat, and it's not home to me. It's everywhere I go is home, but it's like, it's okay. It's temporary. Mm. But like, you know, I love round. I say I built a round house in Somerset and often sort of hang out on there, and it's just a big round structure. So it's, you know, very, very beautiful. There's no corners and it's got character. And I don't know, it's just a nice feature, basically.
What's the best way for people to find out about your future events? Are they listed on a website or what?
I haven't got a website yet. I've been meaning to, but I'm mainly just on Facebook. And just on Facebook, really. So I usually put stuff there on my Facebook page, Ladrhyn Bexx Sound Healer. And the events are usually on there. I've just been a bit quiet at the moment, in December 2018. So I'm putting more on next year for 2019 and more so. So it's going to be good.
What would you tell your younger self?
Oh, crikey, that's a good question. I always thought about that. Like, I've learned now to be more in the moment and be patient. So I think like the things that I've learned, and I guess some of it's to do with the retreat as well. Like when we're doing the build, like there's a few alterations I wish I'd done, but that's not really like me, like emotionally or spiritually for my younger self. Hmm. But I think as a journey, I think probably to save and not waste my money on other things. Hmm. So I mean, being out in the sticks in the country, I got very lonely, and I moved to London like 3 years ago, and I've been here on and off since. And I came back like a couple of years ago, and I was just like sorting things out, and I had so much junk. I was just like, God, like I was looking at the younger me and thinking, oh, like poor Ladrhyn, you know, like he was really lonely. And you know, I know at the time I just spent money on things because I was lonely, you know. No one was into the same things as I was. It's only now that I'm starting to meet people similar ages to me or a bit older or younger that are into what I'm into now. And it was very hard like 10 years ago because there was no one my age into any of this that I found. And so that's one of the reasons why I was very lonely. So yeah, I probably would have told my younger self, like, I don't know, get to a city or something and, you know, hang out with some like-minded people.
Yeah, the ability. That's probably what I said. I think the ability to find like-minded people is really important, isn't it? I mean, I wish I could just press a button and find, you know, 50 friends that are all sort of similar minded to me. It's not always that easy, is it? It feels like a constant quest to me anyway.
Yeah, it's finding your tribe. I mean, me, I don't drink, I don't go out clubbing. It's just not my scene, and I know like the energy that's there, and I try not to be judgmental when I'm saying this. It's just the way I see it is that people get together and get wasted. And really, they come together and they're masking all their problems. They're not really evolving or growing through their stuff, you know. And for me, I like to, I like to see my life, and I like to laugh and humor and make jokes and, you know, be lighthearted. But there's also another side of me where I like to really analyze things and grow, you know, like do a lot of growing. And I think that's very beautiful in itself, because rather than me going down the pub or a club and drinking, and because I don't drink at all, and just, you know, waking up the next morning and forgetting what happened, which I hear from some people, it's kind of like a waste of a life for me in my eyes. You know, this is my reality. You know, if other people are doing what they do, that's their life and that's their choice. But for me, I don't know. I think there's a lot more that life offers that we can learn from. And, you know, I think being sober is a very beautiful thing, you know, being aware of everything and, you know, not getting too lost, basically, if that makes sense.
Yes, I can relate to that. Well, on that note, thank you very much for your time. That was very interesting.
No, likewise. Nice to talk.
I'll get this up online tonight, hopefully within a few hours. So I'll send you the link when it's online. Do you want to send me across some words about yourself? Like, just it doesn't have to be long, just a short bio so that I can put it in the description.
Yeah, sure.
And
Yeah, I'll do that.
any contact details or links or whatever you want in there.
Okay.
But Ladrhyn, thanks very much.
No, thank you.
That was
Thanks for your
great.
time. Nice talking.
Yeah, you too. Have a
And
good Christmas.
happy Christmas Eve.
All right, I'll speak to you soon then.
Yeah, take care.
Cheers, bye for now.
All right, bye.